in James, or in Hebrews chapter 13. We're talking about something that's very, very important. And that's the duty of the church and pastor to each other. The duty of the church and pastor to each other. Very, very important. And the Bible has much to say about that. Now, as we read in Hebrews 13 and then go to James chapter 4, I want you to see what the Bible has to say about how a believer should connect with one another and how we should be very careful about things that would disrupt and stir up strife. Satan is a divider. You got that? Satan is a divider. The Holy Spirit brings us together. The Holy Spirit brings us together. But Satan is a divider. A church will not take the gospel to the world if our church is divided. How many churches split? The missionary support is gone. The preaching is gone. The lights are closed on the building on Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. You get the picture, don't you? And so it's so important that the pastor realizes his duty to the people and the people's responsibility to listen to what the pastor has to say as the Holy Spirit leads him. Now, watch these words as we read. Verse 1, let brotherly love continue. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. I feel like I ought to give this little comment. My pastor as a boy, a young boy, was Wayne Williams. Wayne then went out to South Dakota to pastor a church out there, Victory Baptist Church. And he said it was in the middle of the night, and he had been praying about something and asking the Lord to give him direction, and he just couldn't find a direction. And I'm not going into the entire story, but there was a knock on his door in the middle of the night. And he got up to go to the door, and there stood an Indian in his regalia. And he said to Wayne, he said, I'm traveling through South Dakota going up into Wyoming, but I've run out of gas. I have nothing to eat. I have my wife and my child with me. Could you just give me something for gas and some food? And Wayne said, absolutely. And so he said, you just remain here in the living room, warm yourself, and I'll be right back. And Wayne went into the kitchen and picked up some stuff and came back in. No door had shut, no walking out. The man was just gone. And Wayne said, I prayed about that all night long. And he said the next morning, the Holy Spirit seemed to say, God was testing you to see if you would reach out and help others. And he really believed that he was entertaining an angel unaware. Now, Wayne Williams has a couple of doctor's degrees. He's a competent pastor. I don't think he would just tell that story. But that speaks to me just a little bit. We may have entertained angels unawares. And so we need to be careful how we treat people, regardless of who they are. Now in verse 2 again, be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for by some have entertained angels unaware. Remember them that are in bonds as bound with them, and them which suffer adversity as being yourselves also in the body. Boy, that's pretty strong, isn't it? I wonder how many of us do that. Marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled, but whoremongers and adulterers will God judge. Let your conversation or manner of life be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have. For he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee, so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. Now watch verse 7. Remember them which have the rule over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation or manner of life. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. Be not carried about with divers and strange doctrines, for it is a good thing that the heart be established with grace, not with meats, which have not profited them that have been occupied therein. We have an altar. Wherefore they have no right to eat which serve the tabernacle. For the bodies of those beasts and those whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest for sin, and burned without the camp. Wherefore Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered without the gate. Let us go forth therefore unto him without the camp, bearing his reproach. For here we have no continuing city, but we seek one to come. By him therefore let us offer sacrifices of praise to God continually, that is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. But to do good and to communicate, forget not. For with such sacrifices, God is well pleased. I have that circled in my Bible and ask myself not to forget that. Now, verse 17. Obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls, as they that must give an account. Every preacher ought to know that. Every Sunday school teacher ought to understand that. Every deacon ought to understand that. Obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls, as they that must give an account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief. For that is unprofitable for you. Pray for us, for we trust that we have a good conscience in all things, willing to live honestly. But I beseech you rather to do this, that I may be restored to you sooner. Now the God of peace, that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect or mature in every good work, to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. And I beseech you, brethren, suffer the word of exhortation, for I have written a letter unto you in few words. Know ye that our brother Timothy is set at liberty, with whom, if he comes shortly, I will see you. Salute them that have the rule over you. And all the saints, they of Italy, salute you. Grace be with you all. Amen. Now in James chapter 4. James chapter 4. I'm reading more than I normally do before a sermon, but I just feel like these verses need to be read because of the importance of, I think, what we need to say one to another. Look at verse 1 of chapter 4. From whence come wars and fightings among you? Isn't that a shame that churches fight? That gives the devil a foothold. That gives the world an opportunity to laugh at us and make fun of us. While they can't get along with each other. They talk about God loves them, and they can't get along with each other. I need to remember these things. You need to remember these things. Verse 2, ye lust and have not, you kill and desire to have and cannot attain. You fight in war, yet you have not because you ask not. You ask and receive not because you ask amiss, that you may consume it upon your lust. Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Do ye think that the Scripture saith in vain that the Spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth to envy? But he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he'll draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be afflicted and mourn, weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning, and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. Speak not evil one of another, brethren. He that speaketh evil of his brother and judgeth his brother speaketh evil of the law and judgeth the law. But if thou judge the law, thou art not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. Who art thou that judgest another? Go to now, you that say, today or tomorrow, we will go into such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain. Where is, now watch this verse, where is you know not what shall be on the morrow? For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. For you ought to say, if the Lord will, ye shall live and do this. But now ye rejoice in your boastings. All such rejoicing is evil. Therefore to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. Now look at verse 14 again. Wherefore, as ye know not what shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. You know, we think a year is a long time. But I'm 73 years of age now, 74 coming up, and I remember the seniors in my church when I was just a teenager. All of them are with the Lord now. All of them. And sometimes I think about them, and here's what I think of. They made a difference in my life. Perry Rector, a deacon, made a difference in my life. My pastor, Arthur Estes, and I could go ahead and name their names. They're not here anymore. They're not preaching anymore. They're not singing anymore. Their works is completed. And they're in heaven. They can't do anything else. And one day you're going to be there, and I'm going to be there. And when we arrive on that shore, it'll be a wonderful time. But every opportunity we've had will be gone. Every opportunity to do good to someone will be gone. I stopped in the pharmacy yesterday to ask the pharmacist a question. And as I walked up there, she was a little bit busy. And there was a little sign there that I looked at, and it said this: be the first one to make someone smile today. Be the first one to make someone smile today. Well, let's just be honest. When you or I come into someone's presence, do we make them smile? Or do they have some other thoughts or some other expressions because of the way we live? I'm just simply saying the Bible is full of this idea of life is going to be over. It's like a vapor. It appears for a little time and then it vanishes away. Many folk take church very lightly, very lightly. They come occasionally, just occasionally. Here is the place where God's work is attended to. The Bible says, not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, building one another up. For as you see, the day is approaching. The day of the rapture is approaching. The day of your death is approaching. And we should be able to see that and to give our very, very best to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, let me say once again, I said this last week, but I want to say it again. This church is here for a reason. It's not to come and have parties, and there's nothing wrong with that. And people should fellowship together. I love that, and I love all of that. But the main thrust of this church is to make Jesus known and to take the gospel to the world. And we ought to come and we ought to say, I want to be here Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. You know, you can get far more for your soul sitting in church on Wednesday night than you can at home watching TV. I know I'm meddling. I know that. And you may call me a legalist. And if you want to call me that, call me that. None of us are perfect. But the Lord expects us to be faithful. Amen? And wants us to serve Him with all of our heart. Now, I want to ask you to go back to chapter 12 of Hebrews. Chapter 12 of the book of Hebrews. Now, we're talking about the duty of the church and the pastor to each other, and I'm not going to be in a hurry with this because I think it's just too important to play with it. Now, in chapter 12, verse 1 of Hebrews, wherefore, seeing ye also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight Watch that now. Lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. I get these verses down and read them often. Usually I'll read them when I've blown it. And everyone in this building this week, you blew it some way. By a word you used, or words that you used, or expressions on your face, or attitude, or failing to do something you should have done, and so forth and so on. All of us, you know why? Because we're human. We're human. Yes, I'm born again. Yes, the Holy Spirit lives on the inside. But I also have to go through life in this body. In this body, and the dictates of the flesh, this body. Yes, we're going to blow it, but we need to be very, very careful, because we're being watched constantly. And so he warns us here and admonishes us that we lay aside every weight and the sin that does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Now, I want to read verse 2 and verse 3, and I hope that you're going to get what I'm trying to say to you here. Let's read these two verses. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. I want to remind you that it is Jesus who is the beginner, the author, and the finisher of our faith. There's nothing you can do to bring salvation. There's nothing you can do to add to salvation. It is all of him. Now let me remind you that Jesus did not have to go to the cross and die. He could have walked away and still been God and still been righteous. But the Bible said, watch this now, for the joy that was set before him. I've thought about that, folk, over and over and over again. For the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, bore the shame, and is now set down at the right hand of God the Father. Jesus so wanted people that he could love, that would love him in return. He was willing to pay for our sins, listen, so that we would be with him in heaven. Listen, so he would enjoy us and we would enjoy him. Let that sink in. The next time you say, well, I think I'll just lay out of church, I just don't feel like going. What if Jesus would have got almost to Calvary and said, I'm backing out of this? And he could have. But he said, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despised the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. I can't understand all of that. It's beyond my comprehension to understand all of that. And he'll be explaining that to us in heaven one day. He'll reveal all of that to us. Can you imagine? Listen now, he wants to enjoy heaven with us and enjoy us, and we will enjoy him. And then look in verse 2, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradictions of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. I hope that you'll think about that this week. And I hope that you'll read these verses. Now, when Jesus went to the cross, he was very competent in his work. You were not half saved. You were not partly saved. When he paid for your salvation, he paid for your salvation to be completely paid for. And when he went to the cross, his work was secure. And you and I can be assured that when we bow on our knees and we ask him to come into our heart and be our Savior, our eternal destiny was sealed forever. Amen? And so that's the thing I want to get into your heart and my heart right now, and that's this, that Jesus suffered so he could enjoy eternity with us. Died and rose again, and we can enjoy him. Now, we're talking about the duty of the church to the pastor and the church to each other. The first thing I want you to talk about, I want to talk about, is the duty of the pastor. Then we'll talk about his duty as a preacher. Then we'll talk about the pastor's duty as a pattern unto the flock. And then we'll talk about the church's responsibility to the pastor. First of all, think with me about the duty of the pastor. First of all, he is to feed the flock. Think about that now. He is to feed the flock. Go back to Acts chapter 20. And I hope you brought your Bible with you today. The book of Acts chapter 20. And I want you to look at verse 28. Now, you as a member, as a deacon, as a Sunday school superintendent, whatever, in music, whatever, I want you to understand that the pastor has a responsibility to you. And one of his responsibility is to feed the flock. Now look at verse 28. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock, over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. He is to feed the flock. He is to oversee the flock. If a church is going to be healthy, you have to have a pastor that is called and gifted to preach the word. God gives the man of God a gift, studying, taking it in, practicing it, and then teaching it, and competent in feeding the flock. And of course, the Old Testament shepherd is an illustration of that. A shepherd loved his sheep. A shepherd was very careful in watching the sheep. He would take care of the sheep's wounds. He would not allow the sheep to run off by themselves. And if they did, he knew how to break them from going and running off again. Remember the story in the Old Testament? A sheep would run off, and the shepherd would go get the sheep and break its leg and put it on its shoulder and bring it back, and it would wound up, band up the leg and nurse it back to health, and that little sheep would never go off again. Sometimes a pastor has to preach the word in a manner that folk don't like it. And sometimes a pastor has to go, first of all, by himself and talk to a member, and then maybe has to come back and get the deacons to go with him. That's all a part of church discipline, and that's not an easy thing, and it's a difficult thing. And by the way, if churches practiced that more today, we'd have more holy churches and more godly churches than we have today. Most churches that are meeting this morning have come and met together to have a hullabaloo, to have a dance party, get on stage and gyrate and vibrate all over the place like animals, and they think that's worshiping God. They think that's pleasing to God. And I know that's not popular preaching, but God didn't call me to be popular anyway. I want to be, but I'm going to preach the word. I want to feed the sheep. I want to take care of God's flock. Why? Because I'll give an account. I'll give an account. Have you ever thought about that? Every sermon that's ever preached behind this pulpit by whoever the pastor is, he'll give an account for every sermon that he preaches, every lesson that he's teaching. He'll give an account for every church that he's pastored, all of the members. And so he says, take heed therefore unto yourselves and unto the flock, over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. Did you get that? I am pastoring a church, a flock, that Jesus purchased with his own blood. I don't take that lightly. I don't take that lightly. Now, we have fun with each other. I think Christians should enjoy being with one another. I think we ought to say, man, I can't wait to get to church. Not only for the singing and the preaching and the worship, but being with my friends and being with my brothers and sisters. And so you pray that whoever your pastor is, that he'll have the leadership of the Holy Spirit, that he'll have the depth of study. He'll want to study. Some preachers don't want to study, and you can tell it when they're walking in the pulpit. But you have a man of God that studies and preaches the word, you pray for him. He must do much study to be able to do what? To feed the flock the word of God. Secondly, he has a duty as a student. 2 Timothy 2:15. This is to the preacher. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Now, I know that this might not mean much to you, but it means a lot to me. I have gone to the pulpit as a young man, and I thought I could just walk in the pulpit open wide my mouth and the Lord would fill it. And he did, with hot air. That's an awful feeling. That is an awful feeling. And as a young preacher, I had prepared a sermon, and I thought that was the greatest sermon in the world. Spurgeon never preached anything this good. And then I walked to the pulpit, and when I walked out, I wanted to crawl out under the pews. I was ashamed because I didn't obey the Lord. And so I learned very quickly that a preacher is to study. Why? To show himself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Now that may not mean much to a lot of people in the pew, but it should. I've preached a long time. I've watched people sit in the pew, and I know for certain they're not listening to a thing. Oh, they're looking. But then there's other things to distract them. And you know what? They're the ones that'll lose because they've missed what God wants to say to them. Amen? And so the pastor has a duty. And what is that duty? To feed the flock. And then he must rightly divide the word of truth. And then he must search the scriptures. The book of John chapter 5 verse 39. Search the scriptures. For in them you think you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. Now, that's not just for the preacher. It is for the preacher, but it's for you. Search the scriptures. For in them you think you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. You know, you get to know a person, and you get to love them, and you love to be around them. And that makes life so much more wonderful, doesn't it? You know, a man and a woman fall in love, and they get married, and they go through life, and they know one another, and they love one another, and it's a wonderful thing to come home and to be together. Isn't that a great thing? Well, that's what the Lord wants with his pastors. That's what the Lord wants with you as church members. He wants us to so love one another and so love his word that we will search the scriptures. Now you say, well, preacher, how do I do that? Well, we'll not get into that now, but there's a lot of ways. Get you a good Bible with a good concordance, a good study Bible, and there's good study helps that you can order online, but get in the word. Now, I know you don't have the time, maybe, that I do to study. And a lot of times, weeks, I don't have a lot of time to study because of hospital visits and all of the rest. But all of these years, my first sermon was preached at age 18. And all of these years of preaching, all of these years of study, I still need to study. And I do. You know why? Because you'll never exhaust this blessed book. The Marshall family, I love to hear them sing. I love the old Bible. I love the old Bible. Do you love it? Do you love it? I hope that you do. If you do, you'll read it and practice it and memorize it. Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Secondly, I want you to think about his duty as a preacher. A preacher. First of all, he's a pastor. Oh, and by the way, before I go any further, let me say this. A pastor should go in and out among his people. In and out among them. If they're sick, you need to go visit them in the hospital. If they're sick at home, if they have a need. Now, let me say this. If I don't know you have a need, there's nothing I can do for you.
Amen.
If I don't know you're in the hospital, I can't come and visit you. I don't know how many times in my ministry I've had people be in the hospital. I didn't know anything about it. Nobody called me. Nobody told me. And I got criticized because I didn't go see them. That's okay. I'll just continue to do the best I can. Amen? I want to do my best to be in and out among our people here. And if I know you're in the hospital, if I know you're sick, I will be there unless I'm providentially hindered myself. And as a preacher, we need to preach the word in season and out of season. That's what 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2 says. Preach it when things are going good, and preach it when things are not going so good. You know, sometimes it's hard for a preacher to preach a message because he knows it's going to upset some folk. But God knows that it's good. And you remember here having your dad and mother saying, when they give you a whipping, this will hurt you, hurt me more than it does you. And I wanted to say, why are you lying? Why are you lying? But a preacher needs to preach the truth. Amen? Preach the word. Preach the truth in season, out of season. He must preach willingly. Willingly. To some pastors, it's a job. That's all it is. It's a job, or it's an office, but it's not a ministry. The pastorate is a ministry. Now, the pastorate has a calling. There are a lot of men that preach without a calling. And he must make sure that God has called him and has gifted him to be a pastor. So he'll be able to lead the flock. So he'll be able to go in and out with the flock, but do it willingly. And he must preach it with necessity. I've got to do it. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 16, the Apostle Paul said, I must preach the word. I must serve the Lord Jesus Christ. And then he must be willing to give up much to preach. Turn to Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20. Look at verse 24, if you will. Acts 20, verse 24. But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy, and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. That's the Apostle Paul speaking. Can I say this? If the Lord ever was to lead me away, or if the Lord called me on to heaven, and you're searching for a pastor, make that verse at the forefront of the man that you're looking for. Let me read it again. But none of these things move me. He won't run out on you when the going gets tough. The Lord called me back to my church at Pleasantdale years ago. I was a student at Tennessee Temple, and I just finished up Bible school. And I was going to go on to seminary. And Sue and I were married and so forth and so on. And Sue was a nurse, and she was working on a Sunday morning, and I was getting ready to go to Highland Park. I'd drive from Dayton to Chattanooga to Highland Park to be there in church. And I was just standing, drinking a cup of coffee, and it just seemed like the Lord said to me, "What are you doing?" And I said, "Well, I'm getting ready to go to church." And the Lord said, "Did I call you to preach?" Now, I didn't hear a voice. Okay. I didn't see a vision. And it just seemed like the Lord said, "I called you to preach. Why aren't you preaching?" And I said, "Well, I don't have a, I'm talking, you know." And I said, "Well, I don't have a church to pastor." And then the idea came, "What about your home church at Pleasantdale? It's closed down." They closed it down. And I said, "Well, Lord, if you want me to do it, I'll pray about it." And the next Saturday, I drove up there. And what I saw made me weep. The Sunday school rooms were all boarded up. The auditorium was all boarded up. The parsonage, they had rented it out to a couple. And the old cars were up on stilts out in the front yard of the parsonage. And the man and his wife were sitting out on the front porch of the parsonage drinking beer. And I looked at that and I said, Lord, are you sure? And so I started praying about it, and I asked her to pray with me about it. And I said, next Saturday I'm going to go up and I'm going to visit and see what happens. So I drove up the Concord, down to Pleasantdale Road, down to the Pleasantdale Baptist Church in that area, and just went door to door. Every one of the members that I knocked on their door, except one, said, we've been praying for this. We've been praying for this. Brother Prayer Rector, our deacon, lived up on top of the hill. You look down and see the church, he and his family, and on and on and on. And then I got to the church and visited a house just past the church, and the man sitting on his front porch, he said, oh, no, just keep that thing dead. Catholics have moved in, Pentecostals have moved in. There's no use in opening that old thing up. And boy, that just hurt. That just hurt. But I couldn't get away from it. And so we announced that in 2 weeks we'd have a service and we'd be in the auditorium and that we would see what the church wanted to do. We got there that morning for Sunday school and there's 5 people there and then there's 18 for the main service. And they voted, yes, we want to open the church again. So they said, one of the deacons said, well, preacher, you need to be on the field, and we've rented the parsonage out, but if you would like, if you'll tell them people to move, we'll give them time to move, and we'll help them, and so forth. We had a guy there that was a master carpenter that had retired. And he said, preacher, he said, if they leave and you get them out, I will fix that up, and it'll be fit for you and your family. Well, the next Saturday I went to them and told them, and brother, he cursed me and screamed and yelled, and she did too, and they were drinking beer and all the rest of it. And I just simply said, and in a nice way, you have these many days, and we'll even help you find it. And by the way, we did. We found them a place over on Concord Road. We found them a house. And so they moved, but we had to do all of the cleaning out. To make a long story short, the Lord allowed us to stay there, I guess, almost 11, 12 years. We got to completely redo the Sunday school rooms. We built a Christian school, had a Christian school of 90 in the Christian school out in the country. Beautiful parsonage, a manicure, the yard, and God blessed us. The Lord wanted that church open. Now, I said all that to say this. Wouldn't it be a sad thing one day if people drove up Salamander on Sunday morning and Sunday night and Wednesday night and the lights were off and no cars in the parking lot, no missionaries supporting them like the 28 we're supporting now? Do you love Journey Baptist Church? Then if you love it, let's obey the scripture and love one another. And let me close by saying this. Have a burden for the lost. Keith and Billy were out visiting yesterday. They finished up one of the areas where they were visiting. And I visit by myself usually. And so I was up on Fur Drive here and went by and visited houses on both sides. I got in my car and I went down by our old house where we used to live up there on Salamander Creek Road. And I saw two girls down at the end of the road coming that way and two girls going down that way. And I noticed they had Bibles in their hands. I pulled up right beside of them and I said, young ladies, what church are you from? And I knew what they were. And they said, well, we're Jehovah's Witnesses. And I said to the young girls, I said, could I give you a story real quick? And I told them about their founder, Charles Taz Russell. If you know anything about Charles Taz Russell, the founder of the real Jehovah's Witness movement, you know, and I'm not going to get into it, but they said, oh, no, that could not be true. And I said, ladies, do yourself a favor, please. Search out the truth of your doctrine. There are people like that all around this area that need the gospel. And I hope that your idea of coming here is not just to come here and have a hullabaloo and go home. I hope that you come here to be fed and then to take what you learn here and go out in the community, out in the world, and spread the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what it's all about, folks. We'll finish this up next week, God willing. Stand, if you will, please, with heads bowed and eyes closed.